Let's begin by discussing some fundamental concepts and issues that are important in the context of our setup. Let's start with CNFs. A few years ago, almost all network functions were delivered in the form of dedicated hardware. Hence the name PNF, physical network functions. Depending on the type of functions such as routing, switching, a firewall, etc., the hardware was optimized for a specific mode of operation. Over time, it was decided that the use of such dedicated hardware was not necessary and also that standard IT servers were suitable for use. This is how the NFV concept was born. It brought a significant improvement because, thanks to the NFV, it was possible to run many different virtual network functions on one platform in the form of virtual machines. VNFs are not as hot a topic today as they were 2 or 3 years ago. They often have too much weight or consume too many computing resources. Depending on their internal design, there may be also issues with their scalability and portability in different virtual environments. Instead, more and more attention is being given to cloud-native network functions that use containers rather than VMs and by default have to be adapted for cloud deployment. So what does the term cloud-native mean? Well, let's take a look at the definition given by the CNCF. Cloud-native technologies empower organizations to build and run scalable applications in modern, dynamic environments such as public, private, and hybrid clouds. Containers, service meshes, microservices, immutable infrastructure, and declarative APIs exemplify this approach. These techniques enable loosely coupled systems that are resilient, manageable, and observable. Combined with robust automation, they allow engineers to make high-impact changes frequently and predictably with minimal toil. Now let's examine what service function chaining is. Let's assume that we have a certain set of network functions. They can be CNFs, VNFs, or even PNFs, or a mix of functions. Each of these functions performs packet processing in its own way, depending on what specific function it is. It can be a firewall, DPI, NAT, VPN gateway, etc. Now we want packets to visit this function in a specific order. Note that to do this, as shown in this example, we must ensure that there are direct links between adjacent network functions. This is the first option, but not the only one. An alternative option is to use a programmable switch to which all network functions are connected. Then there is no need to create links between adjacent network functions. The packets visit the network functions in the same order as before, but now they go through the switch each time. So which of these two options is better? Well, there is no simple answer to this question. It all depends on various factors such as in what environment you deploy the network functions, what your network topology and architecture looks like, how you implement traffic forwarding in this architecture, what general limitations you have, etc. Now let's look at an example deployment composed only of CNFs in the Kubernetes environment. Since we are working entirely in the software domain in this case, service function chaining can be implemented based on dedicated direct links between selected CNFs. It is worth noting that quite a few such links may be needed for those CNFs of which you want to belong to more than one chain at the same time. So how can this requirement be addressed in the Kubernetes? Well, normally in Kubernetes, we use CNI plugins to configure network interfaces for containers. However, most of the popular CNI solutions configure only one network interface for each container. Therefore, to meet the requirements for our use case, we can find and use some more advanced CNI plugins we can rely on a completely different mechanism that will provide us with more than one network interface for the container.
Another important aspect is configuration of CNFs. We must remember that we work in a dynamic environment. Both network traffic flow patterns to be handled by the individual CNFs and the number of service function chains may change over time. So how to configure CNF accordingly? Well, two completely different approaches can be applied here. The first approach assumes that each CNF is started up with sufficient configuration to efficiently handle network traffic related to the network topology state at the time. This configuration is never updated for this particular CNF instance. When there is a new network flow to handle or a new CFC is created that the CNF is part of, the current instance is terminated and another is launched with an updated configuration. Another approach is to use a central management system that communicates with each CNF and updates its configuration throughout its lifecycle. However, this assumes that CNF has the appropriate agent implemented. Frankly speaking, both approaches have their drawbacks. The solution may be to apply some kind of hybrid approach. To meet the requirement of cloud-native paradigms, CNFs should also offer an appropriate level of observability. In particular, various types of monitoring applications should be able to continuously read the different metrics provided by the CNF. Finally, we need to take a closer look at the CNFs themselves. First, we need to make sure that each CNF provides the required network functionality, because that is what the CNF is supposed to do. It can be one dominant function like NAT or firewall, or some combination of them. It depends on the real needs and the network architecture in which the CNF are to operate. The second, very important aspect is performance. It is not enough just to provide network functionality in the form of the CNF. The performance they offer must be at the acceptable level, so that they can handle real use cases and the corresponding traffic volumes. Now, how do we address all those aspects within our POC? The network connectivity between CNFs for the purpose of CFC is realized using NSM technology, which is orthogonal network mechanism to CNI, which is normally present in the Kubernetes. The network configuration of all CNF instances is held and centrally managed using etcd. To provide network functions within individual CNFs, we primarily use the vector packet processing technology from the FDIO project. The use of VPP also allows us to obtain the appropriate performance for the CNFs. We use Prometheus to monitor the CNFs. Grafana, on the other hand, allows us to visualize the collected data. To prepare our CNFs to work in such an environment, we must build and configure them accordingly. Here, the Ligato framework comes to our aid, making it possible. As you can see, some of the above-mentioned technologies like etcd, Kubernetes, Prometheus, and Grafana are quite popular today. They are often essential elements of today's architectures, especially those based on microservices and the cloud-native paradigm. On the other hand, technologies and platforms such as VPP, Ligato, or NSM address more specific needs. So now it's time to take a closer look at the latter and understand how they work and what they can bring to us.